When I was a kid and I played Little League Baseball, I was very, very passionate about baseball, baseball player. When we were losing in the last inning, we had a tradition that many of you have probably seen, which was to put on our rally hat. You turn your hat inside out. This is a Bitcoin baseball hat that doesn't fit me at all. But you turn your hat inside out, you put it on, and you rally. 20,000 Bitcoin, 1,000 Ethereum. This is it. This is the line in the sand. I'm going to discuss, obviously, what I'm seeing on the chart and in the markets. But I also have an amazing guest who, unfortunately, we had terrible technical issues last time, a couple of weeks ago, with Suren Markosov from Bullish, who was breaking down exactly why liquidity matters, what they're seeing with volume. And we're going to run that back now, especially in the context of what's happening here at this very, very critical line in the sand. Let's go. Let's go. What is up, everybody? I'm Scott Melker, also known as the Wolf of Wall Street. Before we get started, please subscribe to the channel and take your inside out hat and, I don't know, slap it on the like button. Use your rally hat. Did you guys have rally caps when you were as a kid? We're kids. I bet if you're in the United States that you've seen those before. And we need it. We got to do something. This is the line in the sand. As I said, this is Sparta. This is William Wallace screaming, hold. Hold, but not the part where he screams freedom at the end and he dies. And also not the part where the Spartans lose. Because it's really fun to reference those movies, but they end badly. They end badly. So that's not what we're going for here, obviously. Guys, before we get started, obviously, check out Bullish right down below. Talked about them only 7,948 times to tell you guys why they're an amazing platform. All the benefits of both a centralized exchange and a decentralized exchange mashed into one. And that obviously comes with extremely, extremely deep liquidity, which is what you need in markets, especially when everything is going absolutely haywire and your favorite institutions are collapsing like Lehman Brothers and everything seems to be going wrong. These are the moments right now when, if you do not have deep liquidity, or if you're trading on the wrong platform, where you have those BitMEX moments like March 12th of 2020. We don't talk about BitMEX, no, right? Like in Kanto. But what happened that day? Bitcoin crashed down to around 6,000, and then BitMEX's liquidation engine, which was clearly a POS, and I do not mean proof of stake, started firing into an effectively empty order book with no liquidity, nothing on the books, and could have sent the price of Bitcoin to literal zero if they had not turned it off. That's why liquidity matters. And we tried to tell you about this a couple weeks ago, but apparently I looked like Max Headroom and nobody could hear what we were saying. So I'm going to bring on my friend Suren right now to talk about this again. Suren, welcome. I hope it seems everything's working. Everybody's saying good things.
Now we got these important problems out of the way. All we need is Bitcoin to go up.
Yeah, well, listen, this is really interesting. And it's almost sort of serendipitous that you're back today, because obviously we're at a much more critical point than we were last time. Now, we've talked about, I think everyone has the context, so you can give it quickly, of why liquidity matters so much. I think I just sort of gave a quick overview. But you guys, tell me why this matters so much in these moments.
Yep, absolutely. I think you summarized it pretty well, the liquidity. Everybody remembers why it matters when it disappears, like it did back in March 2020. Then everybody says, where is my liquidity? Until then, people kind of don't worry about it too much unless they have tons and tons to trade. Now, the interesting thing about the last 2 weeks, that despite the sell-off, which of course was quite impressive and massive, the depth of the market, the order book depth, what we call the liquidity, hasn't actually declined. It's actually increased in both Bitcoin and ETH in what we call base currency terms. So in other words, in BTC for the BTC USD pairs, or in ETH for ETH USD pairs, in base currency terms, liquidity actually increased. Now, in dollar terms, it actually declined, of course, because of the prices. But right. It's probably more interesting to see it in terms of its native units in base currency, that it was up about 30% in BTC and about 9% in ETH on a two-week basis. From our last conversation back in early June till now, both of them increased. The liquidity I'm quoting here is at the plus minus 2% level, the kind that you see on the coin market cap and coin gecko pages. It always says depth plus 2%, minus 2%. That liquidity increased the most. But even at the deeper level, like 5%, 10% depth, still we saw something like a 10 to 20% increase in liquidity. So there is definitely, there are multiple interpretations. One is people are starting to back up the truck because they think this is the level, especially if you see the bid side liquidity. On some exchanges, we've seen a significant increase in bid side liquidity, whereas
Right. To your point, when you're saying 5% or 10% spread, that's saying someone is placing massive bids at certain lines below where current price is.
Exactly.
They're trying to catch that knife. Trying to catch the bottom, really. Yeah.
So the upshot of that over the last 2 weeks is that it's been more of a grind down. It may not feel like it, but really it's been pretty orderly. It's nothing like March 2020 was, order books drying out completely. This has been pretty orderly, which makes you wonder, are we at a capitulation point yet?
Which makes you wonder when we get that massive capitulation event where all of a sudden all the bids are removed and nobody's interested in buying.
That's not the forecast. It's just a thought. Another thought is volumes have been huge. Volumes have increased about 100%. Like over a two-week period, we've had some record volumes in both BTC and ETH pairs in the last couple of days. On our exchange, sorry for the plug, but we had another record day. We had a $2.5 billion traded over a 24-hour period. Before that, the record was $2 billion. So not bad for an exchange that was launched in November. So we're now crossed over $50 billion cumulatively since then, since launch. So for us, this volatility has been good as an exchange because a lot of volume going through. But of course, it's not good for everyone. It's good for the shorts, not so good for the longs so far.
That's the beauty of it. I mean, I don't think anyone begrudges the exchange business, which is theoretically neutral. You know, you want obviously to see volume, and that's what you're seeing. The question is there going to be enough of it to hold these lines, right? I mean, we're sitting at 21,386 right now for Bitcoin. That's a decent little bounce. But I think a lot of people thought if we came to 2020, you know, we would see that sort of $6,000 God candle or something all the way up. This makes you wonder, and you have an idea, you gave an idea. I mean, listen, I either think this holds or we get that situation we just discussed. That's not making a grand prediction, right? But if 20 breaks, I have to imagine a lot of people have been liquidated on the way down. I mean, we're seeing literally some of the biggest funds and platforms capitulate and saying that they literally are getting margin called, right? Yep. So maybe most people have been liquidated, so it's not left. But I've got to imagine that there's a huge line in the sand for retail and institutions where a lot of stop losses fire if we go massively below 20. Yeah. And that gives us that major wick in sort of V-shaped recovery.
Well, a wise man once said about 2 weeks ago that there's a bull market, there's a bear market, then there's market to go fishing or something along those lines. There's time to go long, time to go short, and there's time to go fishing. Right?
Livermore. That's a famous quote from Livermore as well. Yeah.
Oh, there you go. Now is not the time to go fishing, I wouldn't think, because it's a make or break kind of environment. You got the Fed decision coming out tonight, and it's going to be interesting. And it's going to be volatile, obviously. But again, with so much liquidity slushing around, we don't expect yet freaky moves. We expect it to be relatively smooth, whichever way it goes.
As everyone obviously is talking about the Fed rate hike, and you and I have talked before sort of about the correlation between markets. I'm just to clarify what people are saying now. There was an expectation of a 50 bip rate hike basically up until inflation numbers were announced on Friday. And now it's 90% on some, like Goldman, I think priced in 0.75 at 90%. So people have to remember when inflation data is absorbed by the market, it's not what the actual number is. It's what the number is versus the expectation. So now 0.75 is no longer actually bad news. And you guys might remember that the last rate hike, we got 0.5, which was the expectation, which was bad because it was originally 0.25 and actually everything pumped for a day before going down. But everything pumped incredibly at the 0.5, which a week before was the worst case scenario. Right. Yeah. So what are you seeing as far as correlation? How do you think that this could potentially affect the crypto market?
Well, it has been running pretty high, obviously, over the last couple of months. It's been almost in lockstep with the fiat market. So whenever, you know, S&P has a some sniffles, Bitcoin has a full-on pneumonia or whatever, some hard COVID. Obviously, we've been sensitive. Crypto markets have been sensitive to fiat. It hasn't always been like this, though. If you look back over longer term, like prior to 2020, the correlation has been a lot lower between equities and Bitcoin. And so if that correlation, that lack of correlation comes back, if it decorrelates again, then I think it would be easier for crypto and Bitcoin to rally, even if the Fed announces a 75 bips hike, just because, you know, it acts on its own accord. So we sort of, if the Fed continues to hike and if it continues to surprise people, then we sort of don't want that correlation to continue between fiat and crypto. It has actually decorrelated a little bit in the last couple of weeks. Like it went from 0.8 to something like 0.6, 0.7. So a little bit of a decline. So if that decline continues, then it'll be probably good for both crypto investors and for people to hold diversified portfolios with both crypto and fiat assets, because the less correlation, the more diversification, the lower their overall portfolio risk.
Right. You made a great point to me when we were chatting before the stream, which was that if you eliminated the news, if you took Celsius out of it and you took Three Arrows Capital, which we'll talk about, out of it, if you took even Luna out of it and you just looked at everything, you would say, everything's down. NASDAQ is down. Facebook, Netflix are all getting crushed. Bitcoin's down.
Yeah. And it's just the Fed. You say, you know, don't fight the Fed kind of thing. You would just attribute it all to the Fed and the interest rate hikes and to inflation. But of course, crypto has its own items, the ones that you mentioned just now, which is part of why the perhaps decorrelation started happening, because independent news flow leads to independent price action. Like the Celsius and Three Arrows, that's not a fiat concern. That's a strictly a crypto concern. Perhaps even ETH more than BTC.
Right. And there's so much conjecture. It's hard to sort and parse, I think, what's fact and what's fiction. But man, what a time to be alive in this market, right?
Definitely, definitely. Keep that powder dry.
So for you guys moving forward, I've got to assume that the main goal is just to make sure that the liquidity we discussed remains.
Well, that's our main thing. Our main kind of raison d'etre, if you will, is liquidity. That's the reason why we have such large volumes already, despite being a young exchange, is because we offer the depth that's actually, if you compare it to some of the largest exchanges out there, we have more liquidity than those exchanges. We put it on our blog recently that, you know, without naming names, but it's like twice the liquidity of one and three times the liquidity of the other. And those are like top exchanges. So we continue to, so for us, volatility brings more volume. In that sense, we're sort of happy. At the same time, we would prefer range-bound markets because our customers would probably would prefer to a straight trend down. We would prefer some mean reversion in this case. Also, even if it doesn't happen, we have enough liquidity to offer for people to position themselves correctly. And we've recently tripled our liquidity, our order book depth in Bitcoin and then in ETH and even in ETH BTC. And so we'll just continue to add more liquidity to the to our exchange and help people out that way, that at least if they need to get into a position, they can do so with low slippage and can trade more frequently than they would otherwise without hurting their returns.
Absolutely love your insight. It's unique from anyone else that we get to have here as a guest. So as I've kind of mentioned, we'd love to have you back if you're willing to If you're willing to join me again, and I think it's extremely valuable and love what you guys are doing. So thank you, sir. And I really appreciate it. And maybe we'll see you back in a couple of weeks.
Sounds good. Sounds good.
Thanks, 68,000 in a few weeks. I'm calling it.
Sounds about right.
Okay. I'll put on the hat for it. Maybe we'll get there. I don't think so.
At least higher than here. At least higher than
yes,
here.
Yes. I'll take anything higher than this number. Thank you, sir. Yeah. I appreciate it.
Thank you. All right. Bye-bye.
Yeah, and so I'm really glad that we got to have him back on because for what you did here 2 weeks ago, everyone was like, wow, this is really interesting. I wish I could hear it. And so now you can. Maybe I'll do like, should I just wear it? It's terrible. I look so dumb. Looks like I've got an ill-fitting hat and then put on a really tight headband to try to make the hat look like it fits. Here we are, guys. Here we are. Let's dig into the other shit that we have to talk about on this day. Tether denies claims of Asian commercial paper backing. Didn't we already do this with Evergrande? My God, stop. Exposure to Three Arrows Capital, which we'll talk about later because all of our favorites apparently push me to the edge. All my friends are dead in the world of words of Little Uzi Vert. Well, we'll get into Three Arrows Capital, but basically they're saying this is a bunch of fake news. It's not the case. And honestly, I do not broker in FUD or whatever, but I am hearing that these are very much coordinated attacks against these platforms once they start to weaken, that there are some very obvious levels to attack with price that can make things very problematic for these platforms. I do not think Tether is one of them. I think that this is inevitably just more FUD, which we've been doing for, I don't know, 5, 6, 7, 10, 27, 39 years of Tether FUD, right? Right? It's absurd. Interestingly, Jeff Dorman from Arca had this tweet that I keep referencing. I keep referencing it for the last 2 days. He said this. Crypto Twitter. Tether must show us exactly each asset they own. Also, Crypto Twitter, the second you show us on-chain proof of assets like Celsius and Luna did, we're going to target your assets and put you out of business. Tough to navigate between full transparency and putting your business at risk. That's the thing, right? If Celsius is transparent and shows you exactly what you can short to liquidate them, it makes it really hard to be transparent, which everyone demands and is arguably, obviously necessary. Now, I actually talked to Jeremy Allaire yesterday, which will come out on Sunday, from Circle, the CEO of USDC. He was like, yeah, dude, we're in three-year treasuries and cash. None of this matters. Have fun attacking treasuries, right? So this is where it really matters what you're backed by. If there's a bank run, if you're a stable coin, certainly. Luna proved that in all horrible possible ways, shapes, and forms. Rally hat, if you're just tuning in. I don't dress like this. This is so we can get more awesome. Right? But it's a big problem. I wrote about it in the newsletter today. Read the newsletter. It's free. You can subscribe down below. It's literally free. It's free. Like, has not a price. It is fucking free. I wrote about MicroStrategy a month ago. MicroStrategy CFO casually says, liquidation price is 20 grand. Not a big deal, bro. We're at 42. We'll just add some collateral. Here we are at 21. Here we are at MicroStrategy's liquidation price. But what nobody tells you, because we love FUD, misinformation, and nonsense, is that barely any of MicroStrategy's coins are collateralized. They have like 120,000 coins and like 96,000 are not collateralized. So I'm not saying they want to add them more and put more at risk, but Saylor came out yesterday and basically said, our liquidation is like 3,000, dude. If we add all that as collateral, we're like 3,000. At that point, we would add more collateral. So we can talk about targeting Celsius and targeting Luna and all of these. You can't target MicroStrategy like people are talking about. They will not get liquidated. Won't happen. Will not happen. Disclaimer, it could happen, and I have no idea what the fuck is going to happen in the future, so don't listen to me because I'm just a guy on YouTube. Anywho, let's talk about Three Arrows. Fuck my life. All of our heroes, man. Never meet your heroes. And listen, I am cheering for all these guys. I want Celsius to pay everyone out. I want these guys not to get margin call, but here we go. Three arrows who have been vocal, huge fund and proponents of the Bitcoin market. Kyle and Suzu, these guys are pretty awesome. I enjoy following them. I like them. It's great. Apparently, rumors started yesterday morning that they were going to get margin called or had gotten margin called, and we had not heard from Suzu or from Kyle Davies for 2 days. Now, I don't have the tweet here. Let me see. But Suzu, basically, after all of that, I don't know why I don't have this tweet pulled up because I'm a chump. But basically, he finally like tweeted, and this is what he said. After all the conjecture, we are in the process of communicating with relevant parties and fully committed to working this out. I said, hey, good luck. We're pulling for you, bro. That's what he said. So that definitely admits that there's something wrong. Guys, I was talking to Emmy about this morning. I was like, you know, I'm pretty upset that like all our shit's blowing up. I'm not talking about our portfolio. That I'm not leveraged. I'm fine. It sucks. Sucks to be 90% poorer in crypto than I was, you know, 5 months ago, 85, 87, 90, who fucking cares? All the same. Ain't selling it anyways. But like, we're doing that Lehman Brothers shit right now, but we have a free market and we don't have a government to bail us out and start printing money, right? If Celsius was Lehman Brothers, I don't know what the hell comes next. Luna, Celsius, potentially three arrows here. Ain't great. Ain't great. I see Tim over here talking about he got SIM swapped. Call right now. Efani, E-F-A-N-I, at Haseeb on H-A-S-E-E-B on Twitter. He is the guy who protects my card. Hit him up right now. He will help you. E-F-A-N-I, call their customer service. Hit up Haseeb with a direct message, H-A-S-E-E-B. I've been SIM swapped. It blows. All right. So that's what's happening here with three arrows. At least a 400 million in liquidations is what they're saying here. Let's hope that they pull this out. I'm not even going to get into the details. But let's talk about charts. We don't talk about charts. No. Let's do some astrology for men. Well, I bought shit, a lot of it. I basically, you know, the old term, throw everything but the kitchen sink. Well, I didn't have that much left. I threw everything but the kitchen sink, and the kitchen sink is literally halfway out the fucking door. Bitcoin at like 20,600 and Ethereum just above 1,000. First of all, I'm a long-term investor, so I don't want to fucking hear it. If it goes to like 19.5 tomorrow, you get liquidated on your donkey ass 50x leverage long and say that I told you to do anything, because I'm not telling you to do anything. I would tell you to do nothing based on anything you see here or on Twitter, and I don't want to hear it. But yeah, if there was ever a line, 20,000 for Bitcoin, that's the top of the 2017 bull market. 1,000 for Ethereum, 400 below the top of the 2018 market, but clearly a psychological level. Arthur Hayes said the same thing. It's basically like, hold on to your dick holes, because if this drops below here, have fun staying poor, right? If you are trading this, not financial advice, shut up. There's no better risk reward than a position here, because you have such clearly defined risk on trades like this. Lose 20,000, stop out. Yeah, then it goes to like your stops at 19.8, it goes to 19,750 and goes back to 39,000 and you get poor. But shut up. I didn't tell you to do anything. I never did. 100 basis points possible today. Honestly, like, there's a part of me that's just like, do 300 basis points, guys, and just like send it. Yeah. Well, I was talking to Cheds privately today, and he says that, but he also said privately, maybe I shouldn't share this. He was like, 20K is a pretty big support. I'd rather be long here and then everyone make fun of me because we didn't go to 12K. Is Scott okay? Have you met me? I'm in my glory right now. Yeah. So anyways, that's the, but the, The monthly chart, lowest RSI potentially ever of all time in history that's ever existed since fire was invented and probably before that, right? But hey, you want to talk about times Scott was super wrong and hates it? Look at this chart. I've shared this 743.9 times. Low breaks the EQ, the dash line. That's the equilibrium. You see that dash line? It's the 50% level of any channel. Equilibrium. When you hear people say EQ or equilibrium, talk about that center dash line. Bottom broke it, went to the top. Broke it down, touched the bottom perfectly. Broke it up, touched the top perfectly. Broke it down, retest, touch the bottom perfectly. This is as solid a channel as you get. This is also the forever bull market of higher highs and higher lows. But we broke above it here. You guys who have been with me since 2020, 2021. I said, there it is. We broke it. We're going to the top. 200K Bitcoin, bitch. Yeah. Happened in the past, has to happen in the future. No. I always gave the caveat. We have no idea. Came down, support. We were like, oh, get in there. Stuff it in by all means necessary. We're testing that line of support. That's what you want. Just like it was resistance here, just like it was support here. Nope. Instead, we broke down, tested it as resistance. And now, actually, the shit is in view for the lows. What? Crazy, man. But yeah, 20,000. If it went this month, that would be 16,000. But what if we just kind of chop sideways and meet it over here in the 20s? That would surprise nobody, right? Maybe we don't even hit it at all. I mean, no big deal. Like we just did here. No, but like, yeah, I've pain train. But when you zoom out, man, that's just a bull market. Well, I mean, shit. Looking at the weekly, we know I've told you about the 200 MA, right? First time it touched, bottom. Second time it touched the giga bottom of the 2019 bear run. 2017, 18, 19, yeah. Giga bottom at March 2020. But there was that big wick below. Well, what happens now? I don't know. But we've almost tried to play just the tip right here with 19,666 on Bitstamp. Front ran it by like $200 today. You never get it exactly. Come on. You either front run it or you nuke it. Talked about that yesterday. We're higher than we were when I talked about that yesterday, which when it went to 20,800. But we're tickling the zipper right outside the jeans right there. You know, that's it's either in or the bottom's either in here or like the liquidations and like under here is going to be nuts. If you were looking to get dig along, by the way, you would push price down to here. Trigger massive shorts because that gives you massive liquidity to buy, right? Trigger all damn shorts and also get all the people who are waiting for a break of that to go short so that you can long all into their face. Yeah, still outside the zipper, but yeah, that 200 EMA dead pushed me to the edge. But guys, I'm going to show you something interesting on the 4-hour chart that I'm going to get made fun of because he talks about bullish divergence all the time and it never works. It works. It just doesn't necessarily mean like the whole fucking bear market's over, you jackasses. Giga mega bullish divergence with oversold RSI on the 4-hour. It's there. I can't make it not be there. RSI went to 12. Bullish divergence, of course, unless we get back up above, I don't know, 22,844, we're going to have hidden bearish divergence, right? This is going to make a higher high. That's going to make a lower high. We're going to have fun saying more. Yeah. At least Kevin's been saying it. Kev, did you ever tell me your Twitter name so I could unblock you, dude? There's no way I don't believe I have you blocked. You're such a gracious and kind person on YouTube. Are you, do you have dual personalities and your dick on Twitter? Could happen. Yeah, guys, I mean, signs are there, but shit, we're one Fed meeting away from just devastation. So who knows? Listen, price close above what I want to see. This is my hopium, though. Guys, hopium. I want to see what we just got. I talked about this. This is what I was saying. Maybe we get down to like 20 and then we close back at 22 too. That's not high. I mean, that's, we have a whole week to go up $700. Right? So it's fine. Bullish divergence sound effect. Did that do it? Did you guys hear that? I haven't even used these, everybody. I don't know, man. We had a phase where we just blocked anyone who used my name and the word stammer. It's kind of a thing. Just block people. You got, I mean, people are like, well, freedom of speech. Yeah, I have the freedom not to hear people's speech too. If you have as many followers as I do, you immediately block out the noise because it will only be noise if you don't do that.
Oh, no. We suck again.
Yeah. Yeah. Anywho, yeah, listen, let's look at the crypto fear and greed index. I bet it's like 5, 6, 8, something like that. I haven't even looked. 7. 7. Yeah, I used to play Pump It Up, but then I would get copyright infringement and like I could get my whole channel removed. But you know what?
You've got to pump it up, and don't you know, pump it up. You've got to pump it up, and don't you know, pump it up. You've got to pump it up, and don't you know, pump it up. You've got to pump it up, and don't you know, pump it up.
I haven't edited that shit, so it would end soon because I'm a DJ. People don't even know about my DJ career. Shit was awesome. Let's keep going on. What the fucking news? We're going from here, guys. I'm going to will that shit. 28K. Dude, say 28, raise you 38, 48. Oh, God. Let's read some more news now so that we can not pump it up. Bitcoin drops towards 20K amid contagion risks in crypto markets. 12-week slide, Celsius, extreme market conditions, three arrows, liquidations, pain, train. Shut up. Nobody wants to hear about that. Oh, here it is, guys. I'm not going to say that Mike Alfred has the crystal ball or is a prophet. But if you were here yesterday morning, I had a very long conversation with Mike, and he said, you know what they did after Madoff? They brought in a third party, a really smart lawyer, to restructure, make sure people got paid out as much as humanly possible. That's what they should do here. And it took all of like 12 hours for that to be announced by the Wall Street Journal. I don't want the Wall Street Journal talking about all of the bad shit. I hate it. Mike has crystal balls, clearly. But yeah, so they hired a law firm. I don't know. Aiken, Gump, Strauss, Hauer, and Feld. 5 guys, hamburgers, and lawyers. Just call yourselves 5 guys. It's not a copyright infringement. One of them's named Gump. Things turned out well for Forrest Gump. That's my boat. Right? He invested in a little fruit company. It's called Apple. Lieutenant Dan got him into that.
Lieutenant Dan. Ice cream.
Forrest Gump is a great movie. I don't know, man. Hiring Gump. Hiring Gump's firm. But yeah, this is what's happening. So like, listen, there's conjecture, but you would have to imagine that this was probably the board taking a move against Mashinsky to probably quietly push him out of the way and hire a law firm. I hate to see this. I do think that Celsius was targeted. I do think that FUD and bad press that was sort of coordinated to some degree. I'm not saying like conspiracy, but you know, once it starts piling on, caused a lot of people to panic, caused a lot of people to make a run on the bank. Any platform like this, including in legacy systems, would not be able to get liquid fast enough if, say, 50% of their customers. That's including every fractional reserve bank, aka bank, aka everywhere your money is sitting everywhere in the world. So I think it is really sad, but hopefully they actually restructure it and people just get paid back. But the odds that like withdrawals are turned back on tomorrow sounds kind of bad.
Life is like a box of chocolates.
That's not the quote. It doesn't last as long if you're fat. That's true, but box of chocolates aren't fat. That doesn't make sense. You're just saying that eating a box of chocolates will make you fat. I see where you went with that, but actually logically, if you read the sentence, it just doesn't work. Right. Honestly, like when you eat a box of chocolates half the time, you know exactly what you're going to get. They have pictures on the thing. I mean, Forrest Gump's not that smart. His mom was pretty smart, though. Forrest Dump. That's what bears do, actually. And all other animals, technically. Does a bear shit in the woods? Takes a forest dump. Thank you. I'll be here all week. Okay, we got some more news. Kevin O'Leary says panic event is needed before crypto bottom. I love this guy. I've sat with him a couple times, but where have you been, man? Feels like we got it. Kevin O'Leary spoke to CoinDesk ahead of the move to the Toronto Stock Exchange of WonderFi, the crypto marketplace in which he is a strategic investor. He's strategically invested. Here's what he said. You don't get a bottom until you have an event, O'Leary told CoinDesk this week. In the crypto world, we need someone to go to zero. Feels bad, man. Also feels like, he said, panic events define bottom. It feels like we got people going to zero, right? So maybe he's just right. And that's what's like, that's like the thing right now. And meanwhile, in the midst of all of this, Celsius's sell token jumps eightfold in intraday spike. Here it is. Sell token. Look at that volume, buying volume that day. Of course, it was rejected, but from 0.09 to 2.5 in a stretch of 24 to 48 hours. Because is this like when Hertz went bankrupt and then 5X because of Wall Street bets? I don't know, man. Shit is wild. But let's not forget, and this is not picking on Celsius because, come on, man. All the charts look like this, but it was an $8 coin. So down just over 90%. That's like, we call that Wednesday. We call that Wednesday. All right, that's all I had prepared. What do you guys got going on there? Any questions? Any funny comments? You guys got some funny comments. I ain't going to try out my new sea legs, but you ain't got no legs, Lieutenant Diane. Yeah, of course. That is just like a short squeeze. When there's massive shorts, somebody just comes in, pumps it, sells at the top, pumps it back down, you know. Scott Melker, what's your name? It's literally my name. It's a weird question. But then again, you are a green cat in a bow tie with a Monopoly guy, aka Mr. Peanut Planter's face situation. Scott, can you host a live stream at 2 p.m. today? I can't because I have other plans, but I see what you did there. We were going to do the Fed thing. We did that before. It was fun. In your mind, what are the chances Celsius depositors get fund? I think very high chance that they get half to most back, but I would say statistically unlikely that you get everything.
Monopoly guy didn't have a monocle. Shut up, Andrew. You're so smart.
Mr. Peanut, does he have one? They're all How about the Ace Ventura guy? Did he have one? Ace Ventura too, that guy? Remember him?
But you ain't got no legs, Lieutenant Diane.
Our exchange is SAFU. I think it depends on your exchange, but I think so. Pretty SAFU. Scott, where do you see XRP going in about 3 years? I don't know. Super fucking sideways like it has for 3 years. I don't know, man. This is the thing. It's like we all want our favorite. I'm not saying what's going to happen with XRP. I hope they defeat the SEC. I hope they pump like mad, regardless of what I think of them. I want everyone to win because it's good for everybody. It's like so bad to cheer for these platforms to go under because, dummies, that hurts your own shit. We talked about this yesterday. I'm not getting into that. But like the odds that like XRP didn't really massively move in this whole bull cycle, and neither did like the Litecoins and the kind of, you know, the older a coin is, the more people are looking to just get out. The next bull run, the alts that win will probably be the ones you haven't even heard of yet. You know what I mean? You literally show up and say Scotty Potty every time as if nobody ever called me that in kindergarten and I have PTSD. What do you think about AVAX? I love AVAX. I think it's awesome. I've had Emin and John both repeatedly on my podcast, but that was one of the heavy positions of both backing Luna, UST, yikes, and Three Arrows, I believe. That just means the token becomes cheaper when there's still fundamentally strong value, so that's good. Do you consider this a new cycle? Not yet. I think we're like in the bear end of a, you know, yeah. Whatever. Let's see what else. Yeah, Litecoin getting removed from exchange because they tried to get Mimblewimble and go privacy with it. Getting Mimble with it. Na 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 na. Na 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 na. Getting wimby with it. Na 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 na. I'm not gonna flick it. I didn't get anything out of there. You look terrible today. Is it the hat? Why do I look terrible? I feel great. Y'all some assholes. I can't stop gazing at your hat. What if I do like this? This get us there? Listen, I mean, I'm gonna get out of here, but I've already probably gotten my channel erased. This is the other music we used to do. Oh, Brandy's here. Hey, Brandy. Yes, the hat's inside out. It's a rally cap. Brandy, you're from, I'm not going to dox you, but I know you. You know about this from like Little League shit, man. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I've already blown it. So let's end it like this. Hit the like button, like people say. You've got to bump it up, don't you know, bump it up. You've got to bump it up, don't you know, bump it up. You've got to bump it up, don't you know, bump it up. Did I get under the shirt? You've got to bump it up, don't you know, bump it up. You've got to bump it up, don't you know, bump it up. You've got to bump it up, don't you know, bump it up. You've got to bump it up, don't you know, bump it up. You've got to bump it up, bump it up. Weren't you saying the bottom is in and bullish divergence for the last 10K? Chris, you're a dick, but I'll answer your question. Those were bottoms, right? I didn't say the bottom. That's where people get confused. You can come here and trill, and troll me all you want. It's fine. They were bottoms. They just weren't the bottom. And I never said they were the bottom. If you're trading and you're looking for, I don't know, 5, 10% move, those are great signals. I never said, hey man, 4-hour chart is showing us the generational bottom of a bear market and a Fed rate hiking cycle with heavy inflation. You know what I'm saying, bro? I'm saying, come here to troll me. I have an idea for you. I don't have an idea for you, bud. Why don't you start a YouTube channel and share every thought you have about what the market's going to do? And put it out there so that random people can come in and tell you were wrong. Super fun. Super fun. Super fun. You should have. You should have. Yeah. Where, someone just said something about 301. I used to say that all mixed up. You don't know what to do. Yeah, I know. That's a good song. I used to know that song, that whole song. I don't know. It's not like whatever. I eat Cheetos and lick my fingers after, and then I rub them on my keyboard. That's how you roll. Yeah, play Monday morning quarterback. Listen, I don't mind. It's fine. But like, yeah, guess what? I'm wrong a lot of the time when I'm guessing about the future. And, you know, the chart says what the chart says. It's not like I made it up. The bullish divergence doesn't work. It's not my fault. It's there. And I showed it to you. Technotronic. Let's get some Technotronic up in here. Get some Technotronic up in here, man. I'm sick of this. I'm going to get every copyright claim I can find right now. Hold up. How do I remove this? Stop screen sharing. Let's do it. I'm going to do it. I got to do it. If I don't have if I do not have a channel tomorrow, you'll know that it's all of your own faults. Let's do this. We're going to get an ad, I bet. Let me wait for the ad to do the ad thing. Always for Inspirato. Always. Okay, skip ad. Ready for it? I had every one of those moves in the 90s.
The jam, pump it up while your feet are stumping, and the jam is pumping. Look ahead, the crowd is jumping. Pump it up a little more, get the party going on the dance floor. See, cause that's where the party's at. and you'll find out if you do that.
Make my day. Hey.
Yo, pump up the jam, pump it up while your feet are.
While your feet are stomping. Don't need to do this anymore. You know what, man? I just took a copyright strike for the team. I've done my part. You guys do yours. Done my part. You guys do yours. I got shit to do. It's been real. It's been fun. I will see you guys. Oh my God, tomorrow roundtable. I don't know if I'm going to make it. NGMI guests tomorrow on the roundtable. It's going to be awesome, but I might be under pressure. Jimmy Song, the maxiest maxi of all the maxis, is going to just come out here and dunk on us and tell us he told us so. Jimmy Song. Robert Breedlove, my friend, also a maxi. They put me next to him at the coin desk, Bitcoin 2022 on the news desk. And like, he literally could have put on a baby Bjorn and worn me like mini me. Crazy. So I got Breedlove, Jimmy Song, and Seth Gittins, my friend. Going to be fucking crazy. Yes, the cap is bulbous. Let's turn it right side in. Right outside rights. Now I got hat head. I look like today is going to be the day that they're going to find me back to you. Look like Oasis out here in these streets. This is the forward. See, this hat fits really good. It's my size. It's perfect. Anyway, y'all, I'll see ya. Peace.